Hey everyone, so let's quickly start with writing the faucet contract for memory token. Similar kind of pattern. First, you define the Solidity compiler version. And get in the ERC20 token. Something seems to be off with my GitHub Copilot. Check that later. Okay, so I'm getting slightly confused here because here it's using something called a standard token. Let's see what that standard token is. Let's ask ChatGPT. Okay, so basically standard token, instead of standard token, what we are using will be an interface to ERC20. Instead of ERC20, let's get interface to ERC20. This is what we'll use to pass an address of the HEMI token and initialize an instance of HEMI token contract. This also defines the owner of token. Which is basically this address. Oh, it has not been set up. But I think, yeah, whosoever created the contract is going to be the owner. Why do we need an owner? Because every faucet request can only be approved by an owner. In this particular scenario, constructor takes the two arguments. One is the token, one is the owner of the token. Put in a withdraw function. You can pass in an amount that has to be withdrawn from the faucet. Anyone can request this. We are limiting the withdrawal amount. Translates to 1000 and decimals is equal to 2. If you remember, decimal means the amount that is sent converted into its lowest unit. For example, for Ether it's 18, so any amount that's sent, it's multiplied by 10 to the power 18. The faucet will call transfer from function of any token. So if you remember, we just discussed that if a third party has to do the transfer, we need to call transfer from function. So this here is your first party, means contract ERC20. This will have a balances mapping. Balances as fsg.sender, which created the contract or the owner. So in fact, owner becomes your first party who owns all the tokens, all the supply tokens of your given contract. This is what is set in inside the constructor. Balances fsg.sender is equal to initial supply. Now, the second party is some user wants to get some token from faucet, and your third party is your faucet. With your withdraw function, which we were just coding up. So this user puts in a request to this withdraw function. Hey, give me 5 MET tokens. The withdraw function instantiates ME token contract and calls the transfer from function. It says, hey, transfer from owner to user. MET. What this does, it goes and updates the balances mapping here, which becomes owner 20,995,000 0x user 5. But to do this, asset needs to be approved and given allowance by owner in original contract. I hope that is clear. Let's quickly put in a require condition. So for this particular scenario, this is how you will go about creating and deploying this whole thing. First of all, you will create your ERC20 contract. You can write the code for it, Solidity. It will have all your the six functions that we talked about. Then what you will do is create your faucet. In first you like code this ERC20 and then you deploy it as well, because why do you need to deploy it or at least get its address? Because this address is hard coded into your ERC20 faucet, so this address is needed. Otherwise, how will the faucet know which contracts transfer from function to call? So the first instance, create and deploy this ERC20, it will give you some sort of an address, 0x123ERC20. It will have your balances mapping, all the other things, six functions, then your two events and so on. You take this address, you put into your faucet, and this faucet opens a interface for the user. Now once your ERC20 is deployed and your faucet contract is deployed, what you do, the third step, you call the approve function in ERC20, because by now you have both the addresses. You have address for the ERC20 here and you have address for the faucet. So by calling approve function in ERC20, what you do, you say, hey, I am the owner, which is your original address that created this contract, as well as created this contract. They might be different, but in this case they are the same. Hey, I am the owner, 0x owner. I am allowing the spender, which is 0x789 faucet, to spend, let's say, 10,000 MET tokens on my behalf. So this becomes part of ERC20 balance mapping, where allowance is updated. Zero X user. 0x faucet allowed to spend 10,000. Right. Once this is done, ERC20 is deployed, faucet is deployed, ERC20 approve function is called, add for an allowance for the faucet address. Once these three steps are done, faucet is ready for usage. Then any user can call the withdraw function on 0x faucet which in turn will trigger transfer from and update ERC20 balances map. The first step process to creating an ERC20, it's faucet, approving an allowance, and then finally user being able to use the faucet. Extremely simplified but very clear application. Can you notice something interesting here that when I'm transferring or when the faucet is transferring, ERC20, what is happening? So originally ERC20 balances and owner at 21 million, which was the only supply. When faucet called transfer from, this mapping got updated to owner as 5. But this mapping is a variable called balances and it is present inside the contract. So contract state was updated. Okay, this is different from sending ether. Here the transaction happens at a protocol level. This is happening through the data field by function invocation. In a transaction. There is a very interesting line that I want to deconstruct. Where ether is transferred by a transaction that has a recipient address as its destination. Destination token transfers occur within the specific contract state and have token contract as their destination. Not the recipient's address. Token contract tracks balances and events. Issues events. So we have seen the structure of a transaction or transaction interface. Let's understand this using the transaction interface. So what will happen for a ether transfer? It is straightforward. It's happening at the protocol level. Again, from is constructed from VRA signature. But just for readability, I'm adding it here. Let's say from Alice, the address is 0xACE to Bob, transfer one ether. Okay, so the as the protocol, the different nodes pick up this transaction, process it, validate it, and update the overall state of the chain as Alice's ether account reduces by one, Bob's ether account ether amount goes up by one. This is happening at the chain or protocol level. The data here is vacant. However, when a ERC-20 token transfer is happening, from maybe like let's say from Alice, who has a particular amount of ERC20 token, the recipient is not the entity or the person receiving. It is not going to be 0x Bob. The recipient is going to be the contract address of ERC20. And it is a data field which is going to be containing a bytes array which has the information key. Hey, invoke transfer function with 2 argument as 0x pop, amount as 10. Okay, so if anyone else also sends, let's say Ethan wants to send it to Alice, so the from address will be Ethan's address, but again the recipient will be the contract address and the data will contain the information as to which function to trigger with the address of Alice inside it, and this is all encoded as a bytes array that the corresponding function can process. This is why ABIs come into picture, where all the different functions are converted to a JSON like object, which is the ABI representation, and you can like using the ABI you can call whichever function you want with the arguments that you wanted to provide it. This is a very important distinction when you are trying to work the ERC20 tokens. This is just building on this difference. This looks interesting. are the differences between transactions and messages. Interesting. So it appears these are four key ERCs that we'll need to look into. ERC 77 and 155. Okay, so I think that is it for the tokens today. We'll come back tomorrow and we'll start with ERC 777, ERC 721 and ERC 1155. I'll start the stream again with a different topic where we'll be working on the Farcaster Frames project for the raffle. See you on the other side.